Welcome to Plugged Inland. I'm Roger Bowman. Tonight, we're going to explore an innovative way some educators are engaging the minds of their students through hip-hop. Whether you're a fan or not, your kids likely are, and teachers who embrace and incorporate hip-hop into their curriculum are connecting with these youth. Now it's you.
UCR theater professor Rickerby Hinds personifies the best of our humanities pedagogy. A respect for the traditions of his chosen medium and the courage to revitalize his craft by drawing in new forms of expression and new audiences. His work with UCR students, inner city youth, and hip hop culture is helping to keep theater and UCR's great commitment to diversity vital and fully engaged in the community.
For me, hip hop theater is theater that is created using the elements of hip hop culture as the foundation for the stage. So we have MCing, we have breakdancing, we have DJing, and then we have graffiti art as the four foundational elements. And so within hip hop theater, what we do is we take these elements either separately or in conjunction with each other, and we couple them or we fuse them with your traditional theatrical presentational forms and hopefully create a new, maybe not even necessarily new, but a different means of storytelling on the stage. I'm one of those people who believe that there's an artistry to teaching. There is, when I come to the classroom, I actually like to come, and I know, you know, probably all professors come with a plan of action as to the journey of the class. And obviously a lot of that has to do with being a playwright and understanding, you know, to some degree the rhythms of the play and reaching a climax and how to kind of keep the action moving forward. And so within the context of the class, when we're dealing with things like criticism, with the students acting out the roles, with how much time I give them to come up with a concept and execute that. All of those things, I think those through based on my own experience in workshops and in classroom settings, as well as having participated in a lot of readings where you have feedback from an audience and where you have the talk back. And some of those have been amazingly useful, and some of them have been mildly painful when not, you know, when they're not conducted in a useful, proper way. And I think the idea is if you look at what you're doing as telling a really great story, and this is what I tell my students, when you sit down to write, it doesn't matter who the characters are, if they're human beings or if they're animals in the fields or if they're, you know, roaches. If you're telling a really compelling story, you will engage the audience, and we will find our humanity in that, and that's where we'll tap into it and where we'll care. And that's when these things work. And I think even in the sciences and even in all the fields, if we can figure out where we tap in or where we our humanity locks into these abstract concepts, if we can somehow see ourselves in that thing, I think it just makes it more accessible and it makes it easier for students to be engaged, which in turn hopefully will make it easier for them to learn.
Plugged Inland represents KVCR's continuing interest in focusing on important issues in the inland area. Supported by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, we're looking into innovations and solutions in education as part of the American Graduate Let's Make It Happen. And you can help us make it happen. Call us anytime during the show at 866-367-5827. Or you can send questions or comments right from our website at pluggedinland.org. Or you can email us questions and comments to questions@pluggedinland.org. And you can tweet us at @KVCR.
I'm pleased to welcome the professor we've just been hearing from, Rickerby Hinds, into the studio. With him is a former student of Rickerby's, Carrie Mikuls. Thank you both for being here tonight.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So, to beatbox or not to beatbox? That is the question.
That is
really
the question.
Really? Hamlet? Through hip-hop.
Yes. One of the things that started happening early on in hip-hop theater
were adaptations of the classics. And in some ways, that was a safe point of departure, because within hip-hop culture, there's always a sense of trying to legitimize itself within popular culture, within American culture. So the idea of, hey, you know, if we take Shakespeare, which is the epitome of theater, and we adapt it to a hip-hop beat, or, you know, I think Bombardy of Errors is one of the plays that was written by the Q brothers, who are doing, adapting all of Shakespeare's plays is their goal. And so, you know, this idea of taking things that are classics speaks to hip-hop culture's beginnings, and how hip-hop takes something that might be considered dead. I mean, James Brown, you know, somebody in one rap said James Brown was considered old until Eric B. and Rakim wrote, you know, I Got Soul. So once again, it's a way of taking something from the past, flipping it, and turning it into something contemporary or even futuristic in some cases.
And that's what you do. Not necessarily the adaptations, though you participated in those.
Absolutely.
But you are a professor of art.
Yes.
And a playwright.
Yes.
And you are known for hip-hop theater.
I am known, I guess, yeah, let's just say I'm known for hip-hop theater, of course, yes. The work that I do, I'm a professor primarily defined as a playwright, but I also direct and produce work. And this work is done primarily in the hip-hop theater genre, meaning that I use the founding elements of hip-hop culture to create theater. MCing, DJing, graffiti art, and I always forget one, breakdancing. And then the fifth element of hip-hop culture is knowledge.
Now run through those for just a moment.
Let's slow
MCing,
yes.
What is that?
MCing is rapping, and the way I extrapolate it is it's the word manifestation, the spoken manifestation of hip-hop culture. So if hip-hop was only spoken, then rap or MCing would be the way hip-hop existed. And it's the same thing with the other elements. So, you know, and MCing is the one that we know about. We know rappers, you know, we can go down the list. But if you look at DJing as well, it's the auditory, it's the musical manifestation of hip-hop culture. And so that can be extrapolated into beatboxing or even...
And explain beatboxing.
You know, beatboxing is the art of creating percussive sounds using your mouth, your tongues, your lips.
Can you emulate it even a little?
I can't even... That's
we all know what that is.
Somebody,
somebody
will be like, Curve, don't do it. Don't do it.
We all saw Police Academy, the original one.
Absolutely.
And that guy was good, you know, on the microphone for emulating sounds.
Absolutely. And beatboxing has, you know, it has the ability. And once again, it started in the same way hip hop culture started, which was out of necessity. So if you're out on the block and you can't plug your radio into somebody's plug somewhere and you're an MC and you need a beat, what are we going to do? So beatboxing became, you know, once again, a way of creating something out of nothing or finding what it is you need in order, you know, finding what you have in order to create what you need.
A lot of hip hop started as the body is the instrument, did it not?
Absolutely. Yes. I mean, you have...
Touch on a couple.
Well, if you look at breakdancing, for instance, you know, the breakdancing became the body's narrative, the body's way of telling a story in a very compelling and a very, very powerful way, and in a way that was almost defying what was considered to be proper dance. So in proper dancing at the time, you didn't get on your back and spin around, you know. And so once again, it was this idea of innovating and using what you have access to, the what do I have? And I look around and I say, okay, I have my body. So I can speak, maybe I can't sing, but I can speak rhythmically. I can dance. And, you know, with graffiti art even, when you look at someone who may be an artist at heart and they don't have access to a canvas and brushes or those things that, you know, we imagine the masters would use. And so they say, well, you know, I still am a visual artist, so I'm going to take this paint, I'm going to go to the train yard in the middle of the night, in the dark, and I'm going to create a piece of work while I'm dodging the police and climbing over barbed wire that's going to be on this train that's going to go to all five boroughs in New York. And so once again, I am confined physically to the Bronx, but my work can go to the other four boroughs.
Is that one of the reasons that trucks and trains are so popular?
Well, how else do you get your work out? I mean, you know, we...
Because it's not the typical, like, gang member marking a territory, because obviously the train leaves.
Yes.
So your territory isn't as expensive as where the train goes.
No.
That's an interesting take.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's you know, it's media. It's us saying, hey, you know, we want my face on a TV somewhere else. How do I do that when I don't have access to these things? And once again, it was the lack of access that spurned the birth of hip-hop culture.
Carrie, where did you intersect with Rickerby?
It was when, I think it was my last year at UCR, and I was a dance major, and I had this final piece that I was working on called Words and Manipulation. And what I wanted to do was take hip-hop and modern dance and create the movement together, and then add spoken word on top of that. So use the text. So spoken word would be considered in the MC element. So one of my professors, Neil Greenberg, suggested that I get in contact with Rickerby. So I emailed him.
Immediately answered your call.
Immediately. No. I emailed him, and he, the busy man that he was at the time and is, he did not get back to me, but he ended up coming. I used a Lauryn Hill song instead, War in the Mind. And he came and saw the show, not knowing the connection, and he saw my work, didn't know I was the one that emailed him, and came up to me after the show and said, I have to work with you. And we've been working together ever since. So
that was about 4 years ago?
Yeah, 2008, I think. 2008.
And you participated in one of his more recent works, mm-hmm. Dreamscape.
Dreamscape, yes. That was really fun. We actually put it on two different casts, and the movement with that was more... I would say more modern with little infusions of hip-hop movement, but with the storyline. And, like, you are familiar with the storyline?
Yeah, but we're going to go over
okay.
it.
Okay. Well, with, like, the bullet wounds that hit her. So, and...
Okay, so stop there.
Okay.
A moment, and tell us about that work. That is a work that is your most recent work. Is that
yes.
right?
Yes. It's the most recent one that I've produced. I actually wrote it in 2005. So Dreamscape is a play based on the shooting of a young woman named Tyesha Miller in 1998 in Riverside, California, by four police officers. And the play itself is not a reenactment, it's not a biographical sketch of Tyesha Miller, but it's a re-envisioning of the moment in which she was shot 12 times. And so what happens in this production is the entire play, or the journey of the play, takes place in the amount of time that it would take for her to be shot 12 times. And each of the 12 bullets that hit her manifests itself in three ways. One, through movement. So what part, and Carrie should probably do this, but what part of the body was affected, and what, you know, so what the body, what she might have been thinking. So if I was a 19-year-old black girl being shot to death by the police, what might be going through my head? And then the other way that it manifests itself was through the coroner's report, which became her antagonist. And the journey is, if I'm being shot to death, if I can stop the coroner from declaring me dead, maybe I can live. And so through these three methods, we take the journey of this young woman.
Let's take a look at an example of that. We have a piece of tape.
May your day be so.
That is not you.
A very moving,
culturally loaded subject to bring to performance art.
Yes, yes. I hesitated in writing this play. I was very hesitant to sit down and tell the story because, you know, it wasn't something that I wanted to jump into and take myself to the place where I had to take myself in order to tell the story. Years after the incident happened, and, you know, a lot of times as artists we think somebody else will do it, and nobody else did it. So I thought something needs to be said about this relationship between the Black community and the police. This you know, I'm a professor at a university, but when I see a cop pull up behind me, I'm no longer a professor at a university. I am, you know, a Black man in a car.
And we talked about these antecedents, even Ice-T and Cop Killer.
Absolutely. Well, you know, when you look at Ice-T's Cop Killer, and, you know, people begin with Ice-T, a lot of people begin their narrative of Ice-T with Cop Killer. And I actually like going back to Six in the Morning, which is, you know, his narrative of the police busting down his door using the battle ram that Daryl Gates invented. And, you know, they would basically bust down your door and come to find drugs or look for drug dealers. And he started off with Six in the Morning and talking about that incident. But when you meet him at Cop Killer, he's been frustrated saying, listen, the cops have been knocking down my doors, and when they find nothing, and my being a plural for those who exist in these communities, where you can knock down a door and just go, you know, sorry about that, we missed the drugs. So he said, look, I've been doing that, I've been saying that, so now I'm gonna say it a little bit more directly. And so the thing with hip-hop culture, with the MCing part of hip-hop culture, because that's one element, is that it's reflective of American culture. You know, the things you say, go to college, get a good education, get a job so you can get paid. Become a lawyer so you can become a doctor so, you know, yeah, you're gonna heal people, but dude, you're gonna get paid. Well, the difference is hip-hop artists say, yeah, I did these things and now I'm getting paid, and they have a microphone and they're blasting it out. So their volume is just louder than the lawyer or the doctor or, you know, the Wall Street people who are saying I'm getting paid, but they're just not using a mic. They're just taking your house and your car and your future and, you know, not saying it to you, just doing it to you.
I'm going to circle back to Dreamscape. Carrie, you actually participated in that. You helped with the choreography.
Yeah, I did the choreography. I also was in rehearsal most of the time. And so with the actual choreography itself, I got to go back to the 1998 period, which I grew up listening to that music and during that time. And so kind of use some of those hip hop movements from that time and put it on Rachel and Natalie, which are our two women that play.
And what we saw was a rehearsal, right?
That was a rehearsal.
Right. Mm-hmm. So that wasn't actually the performance. Your performances are done not only at UCR, but in the past, your performances have gone to many universities all over the world.
Absolutely, absolutely. We've actually premiered this version of Dreamscape at Arizona State University, and subsequently we've gone to, obviously we've done at UCR, we've done UC Santa Barbara. We are on our way to the Oregon Shakespeare Festival in July to do a performance there. And we are taking this work as far as we can take it, as far as, you know, putting this piece out there as a hip-hop theater piece that is done with two actors. And inevitably, when people see the performance, they're like, wow, that's, you're doing so much with so little. Once again, going back to, this is what we have to work with. And so this is what, you know, this is how innovative we're going to be with the work.
In other words, it'd almost be a violation of the genre's roots if you brought in a whole ensemble cast.
Well, maybe not, because the Wu-Tang Clan had a whole lot of people in their group, and they figured out how to, you know, how to have them all do different things. Mm-hmm. I think the great thing about hip-hop culture is that it functions within whatever space it finds itself in. So when I did Buck World 1, which was another performance that we did and Carrie choreographed, and we took to New York and to Oregon. It became actually the first hip-hop theater piece done at the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. We had a cast of 10 dancers and 4 poets at one point. And once again, that piece, you know, it was created in a space where we had access to these dancers, we had access to poets. And so we looked around the room and I said, okay, who does what?
Now, I don't think a lot of our audience is going to get what Buck World One represents. I'm thinking Buck Rogers. So tell me about it. I know it applies to crump.
Yes.
Well, I don't even know what that is.
Wow. Okay, so there's a dance form that originated in Los Angeles. It evolved out of this other dance form called clown dancing, and it became known as crump dancing. And crump dancing is this very energetic, dynamic, I could do one move, like what, and that'll be it. But it's this energetic, dynamic dance style that was done for a long period of time, primarily by African-American young men. And so we went into, I was asked to come down and do some work in San Bernardino at the Central City Lutheran Mission. And so when I went there, what they would do is they had these crump sessions. And in the Inland Empire, they started calling crumping getting buck. So it's a synonym for crump. So crump and getting buck are the same thing. And so that's where Buck World One came out of the language. And so it's a piece using crump, spoken word, video projections to tell the story of our existence in the universe.
Carrie, we saw an example of that in Stomp the Yard, didn't we? Crump dancing?
Yeah, crump dancing. And then, of course, Rise, if some people are familiar with Rise. Chris Brown, I believe, a lot of other artists have used crump in a lot of their music videos and on stage. And
so now
it's
hyper-aggressive. You've become the prodigy. Now you're taking your education in hip-hop theater from Rickerby, and you're branching off on your own.
Yeah. I'm just finished teaching in Los Angeles. I taught a group of high school kids out there, also in the Inland Empire as well, along with Eric, who you'll see later. Me and Eric, we would use the dynamics that we would use in Kirby's class or that he taught us. We'd borrow from him. We'd come up with new things. I'd borrow from Eric. He'd borrow from me. And so basically we're kind of spreading this hip hop theater genre around to these kids and giving them something to put their energy into, whether they're dancers, whether they can write, whether they think they can sing or dance, anything. They put this energy into some kind of performance. We try to put some kind of performance together to get these kids in front of people and to actually see what it's like to be doing improv and things like that. And freestyle is what hip hop really was. Freestyle, just going off the top of your head if you're doing MC. Breakdancing is just all freestyle to begin with. That was
freestyle
the
roots. Being nothing was choreographed beforehand. Nothing,
you just go.
The lyrics weren't written beforehand. You just go with it.
You just
in
go.
The moment.
Yeah. And I mean, a lot of artists would have kind of knew what they were going to do before they came out and did it. A lot of dancers do that now as well. But these kids, we'd kind of give them the tools to create their own theater. And so that's kind of what Kirby
Let's
has taught us
call.
To do.
Let's take a quick call. Let's go out to Fontana Sharon. Thank you for calling. What's your question?
Yes, I was wondering if the professor teaches general playwright techniques, or is it all related to hip-hop?
Good question.
Oh, absolutely. I am probably traditional in my playwriting classes in that we deal with those basic foundational elements of Aristotle. So when I teach my playwriting classes and when I teach hip-hop theater, we deal with, you know, those six elements of plot, theme, character, dialogue, music, and spectacle, and how those tools, those elements are used in storytelling. You know, protagonist, antagonist. I have a protagonist. What does he or she want, and what is stopping him or her from getting that is the basic foundational premise of storytelling when it comes to anything that I do. And so even when we're working on a piece that's choreographed, if you're dancing, I still want to know what is it that you want as a dancer. You're not just doing your thing because you want to do it, but there's a narrative. There's a journey that the character is taking. So absolutely, those basic foundational elements are definitely present in the work that I do with my graduate students at UC Riverside, and absolutely with the work that I do in the community and everywhere else. Because I think that there's something really great about having those foundational elements to fall back on and to be able to say, listen, we're putting this piece together. What's the dialogue? How do the characters speak to each other? You know, where's the music and the spectacle? How do we make something that makes people go, wow? You know, because after all, it's still theater. It's still this idea of engaging an audience in order to deliver a message. Doesn't matter how great the message is if nobody listens. It's, you know.
I'm going to take us off track a little bit. You know, we've examined hip-hop as an expressive medium for cultural issues, but some educators are using it as a teaching medium. Let's take a look at one such program.
My name is Christopher Emden. I am an assistant professor at Teachers College, Columbia University in the Department of Science Education. And the title of my co-authored paper with Oki Lee from the University of Miami is Hip Hop, the Obama Effect in Urban Science Education. And the paper is really an outgrowth of 4 years of study in urban settings, trying to find ways to get youth to be more engaged in science. And so in this paper, I really focus on hip hop and hip hop culture. And then delving deeply into the literature, found that all the work that is done in hip hop and hip hop based education focuses exclusively on either literacy or social studies. And so in this paper, I really sort of push against the existent literature in hip hop based education by saying it's about time we look at hip hop more as a cultural understanding, a way of knowing and being that youth are involved in, a distinct way of talk, a distinct way of dress, a distinct sort of way of looking at the world. There are things about hip hop culture that are distinctly scientific. The ways of communication of scientists are replicated in hip hop. The collaboration with scientists. I always tell folks, you know, when was the last time you saw a scientist write a single authored paper? They're all co-authored. This connection between experts in a field in describing their experience is purely scientific, but it's also purely hip hop. The notion of observation as a key tenet of science. I mean, rappers all the time base their raps based on observations of their life. And so hip hop, in a sense, is so attuned and so aligned to science that, you know, as educators, we have to be more aware of the fact that we can use this tool to connect youth to the discipline.
When all the facts are prime, write the problem, least the great, repeated facts can be combined for expression into forms.
And then also the Obama effect. And so, you know, the question always is, what is the Obama effect? And there's been some scholars and researchers that have looked at this idea of the effects that the running for office and subsequent election of President Obama has had on people from various urban settings. You know, what is it about Obama's presence that has had an impact on people? And people oftentimes connect to him because of his African-Americanness, some for his biracialness. But I find that youth in urban settings connect with President Obama really because of his hip-hopness, so his exhibition of certain hip-hop type characteristics. And this could be superficial to the fact that if you ask him, he says, you know, he has Jay-Z or, you know, in his iPod, but also the distinct sort of ways of talk and dress. The fact that over the course of the primaries, he gave, you know, Michelle Obama a pound, or when he was being critiqued, he dusts his shoulders off. And so these sort of really, you know, fine, not really overt exhibitions of hip hop characteristics go over the head of the layperson. But for youth who are immersed in hip hop, they say, wow, this dude is down with us. If they connect to President Obama and the fact that he's sort of a key figure in a political sphere, then maybe we can use his presence to open them up to new worlds beyond the local worlds that they're embedded in.
Joining us now is a past student of Rickerby's, Eric Montgomery. Welcome to the show, Eric. Good to have you.
How you doing?
Good. Now, what we saw from Chris Edmond is the example first of a close reading of a song. He had one from Jay-Z. You do that a little bit, do you not, Rickerby?
Yes, actually, one of the exercises, one of the papers that my students do in my hip hop theater class is we do a close reading of a song. And in the past, I have done Jay-Z, Kanye, and Kanye West, Diamonds from Sierra Leone. And what we do is we take the song and we look at everything from the samples that are used to the lyrics.
And he sampled Diamonds Are Forever.
He samples Diamonds Are Forever, right? Which is either James Bond, I never remember if it's James Bond or if it's another classic American movie. But once again, by taking that sample and now using it within this context, shifts the significance of it. And then speaking about, you know, diamonds themselves and their significance and jewelry, you push the limit of what can be said and what can be explored. And if you look at the song, I mean, there's so many nuances, so many references. You know, there's one line where Jay-Z said, I had to get off the boat so I could walk on water. And people will look at that and go, well, this is Jay-Z saying he's Jehovah, that he is, you know, a god. And someone who knows the reference a little bit further understands that he's talking about leaving one record label to start another record label to prove that this is how good I am. Now, it could have both meanings, but once again, if you understand, you know, the depth of, and that's just with the lyrics. I'm not even, you know, we're not even talking about some of the references to, you know, when Kanye says it's in a black person's soul to rock that goal. Do we take that as being factual? Is it in the black people's soul to wear gold jewelry? Or is that a point to be debated?
Nature versus nurture.
Absolutely. You know, are we taking back the goal because the goal was taken from us? Or, you know, have we been trained to believe that if I wear this jewelry, if I drive a Cadillac, if I do these certain things, then it speaks to my status in this society versus I was born black, therefore I must wear some gold. So it's an opportunity where you could write an entire paper just on that sentence. So once again, doing a close reading of a song, of songs, I mean, it's an amazing process. And it's great to see students who will take a song that they've heard over and over again. You know, I got 99 problems, but, you know, a B ain't one. And break down what is being talked about in the song that they've listened to over and over again.
So you're saying all rap has that level of depth in its lyrics?
Not all. I mean, you know. If Soulja Boy is doing Superman, it's one level of depth. But I think even in songs that seem, you know, LL's I Need Love. If you just listen to LL Cool J doing I Need Love when I'm alone in my room, sometimes I stare at the wall. And you're like, oh, this is a guy, you know, saying that he likes this girl. Well, if you don't understand that before LL Cool J did I Need Love, there was no slow hip hop song. So the significance of this rapper who is hard, you know, slowing down a song and being sentimental, once again, has significance beyond just, okay, these are just nice sappy lyrics. And you know, it's a cool song, but there are depths that you can go to with the reading of a song. And if you understand, you know, and with Eric, what's great about working with Eric is Eric's knowledge and understanding of hip hop culture and rap and lyrics and all these things is so deep that there are things that he'll go, curve, man, you know, this, and this. And I'm like, wow, yeah, okay, I didn't know that. and it's really great to work with him on projects and, you know, to see him starting to forge his own space in this.
So Eric, what are you doing now?
I'm currently a freelance writer for XXL.com. It's a hip hop publication. I also write for TheExaminer.com. I've been going out and seeing different events, covering different events, such as Coachella, Pay Dues. I'm covering Rock the Bells this summer. And one of the interesting things that, to piggyback on what Kurt was saying about the lyricism in hip hop now, I think before I met Kurt, I was looking at rap music surface level a lot. Taking classes with him forces you to understand why certain words should go with certain words. And as a rapper, a lot of times, I started off as a rapper. You just try to make words rhyme. That's the first thing you learn. I'm gonna just make these words rhyme. But coming with an understanding that certain words they have space within them. And I know you probably can speak of this. You can almost find like this space between words, like this space that nobody talks about. But as a writer, you know what that is.
Yes.
So what you try to do is find, you bridge those gaps between that space. And I think really great lyricists, such as a Jay-Z, they know how to manipulate that space better than other people. So now when I go and listen to a song that may be playing on the radio over and over again, I'm like, okay, there's something wrong with the space between what he's saying. Like, I could do that better. One rapper that I've come to admire lately that I met at Coachella was Kendrick Lamar. And one thing he does, he navigates that space really well. And for somebody that young to do that, it's amazing to me. And if you talk to him, it's almost like talking to Morpheus from The Matrix. Like, you got this little dude, he's like 5'2", and I'm like, he's telling me things that I wouldn't even never thought of.
And now, you went into a master's program, did you not?
Right.
And these young rappers, these lyricists, They didn't get a master's program. Where did they pick this up?
I think a lot of it just comes from the people that you have around you. For instance, when I was coming up, when I first discovered that I had a knack with words, I surrounded myself with people that I thought were better than me. And my whole goal was to get on an equal level with them as far as my wordplay, just my observational skills about the things that were going on around me, just being able to take things in and kind of recreate them on the fly. A lot of times that education comes from your surroundings. Everybody has a different story. Kirk talked about Kanye. One thing that I admire about Kanye is he's not from the quote unquote ghetto. He's not involved in violence and drugs. But yet here you have this person that is almost like an everyman that has a story to tell too, that's almost in direct conflict with what Jay-Z is saying. But they're doing the same, they have the same goal, which is to be the best.
So many artists seem to go the route of provocation. Even in the case of Kanye West, he was provocative in his trying to boycott MTV for not being awarded, for stepping on Taylor Smith's award. You know, he gets out there for his George Bush statement, as opposed to other artists that are provocative in their lyrics, just completely controversial. We talked a little bit about Ice-T, and you mentioned LL Cool J, and now they're both TV stars. They're completely mainstream. It seems to me that what we consider provocative this year is fairly humanized and normalized 5 years from now, and we see the artist as human and dealing with all these same experiences everybody does.
Well, you know, Elvis was shaking his hips, you know, and now he's the king. I mean, if you look at hip-hop culture and you look at other cultural manifestations, be it the blues, be it jazz, be it rock and roll, or even gospel music, which, you know, is one of my favorite genres to look at and explore, how, you know, at a certain point in gospel music, having drums in the church was blasphemous. I mean, you were on the gateway to hell. You were right at the doors of hell if
That's
you
true.
Had drums.
I know somebody that grew up in a very strict Christian school who says that staccato is the work of the devil.
Absolutely. And so once again, but you have a whole segment, you know, from Kirk Franklin to, you know, James Cleveland, to the Winans, to, you know, Shirley Caesar, who are using drums in their music. And once again, the lack of knowledge, especially if you look at the African-American community and drums, and you look at the role that drums or lack of drums has played in our history in this country, then for you to say, well, we shouldn't play drums because the lack of drums gets me closer to God, well, who told you that? You know, what is it, what music is it that gets you closer to God? And once again, if you look at it, you know, it's the music that's kind of, it's the Gregorian monkish type music, which alludes back to where the Christian church came from, which is out of the Catholic church, which is where that music comes from. So we're still going back to trying to be Catholics in a way, because we're saying this is the closest thing to God. And so it's, I mean, if we take these things in a vacuum, if we take any of these issues with hip hop culture in a vacuum, and we don't understand that there is, you know, there's a construct, there's a bigger picture. Hip hop culture is a microcosm of American popular culture, which is, you know, a microcosm in a lot of ways of the way the world functions. And so if we understand that, we may still decide to demonize hip-hop culture and say, you know, the Illuminati and Jay-Z and they're trying to control the minds of the youth for a greater purpose, or, you know, some type of sinister thing. We may still choose to say that, but we may be saying it with a different level of understanding and not just functioning in a vacuum and saying this thing is evil.
So, Curb, are you saying there is no Illuminati?
I don't address the Illuminati on television. Or, you know, I don't know. I don't know. And I believe that, you know, there, look, we whether or not whatever religious or you know, background or spiritual background that you come from, we, for the most part, believe that it's not just us. There's more to our existence in this space than what we're able to see. And so, however you put push, whatever direction you push that in, becomes what it is that you believe in. You know, whether we believe that prayer actually has power, you know, I mean, there's that belief that I can say something to you or about you somewhere else and cause something to happen to you. Good, hopefully, but you know, there's that belief that there's this other force than what we can actually see and do. So, you know, I don't know.
I'm going to shift gears, Eric. I know your career has taken you not only as a writer and a contributor, but you've done everything from working with Carrie in hip hop theater and acting, commercials.
Oh yeah, yes. That's pretty cool. That's my famous line right now. I did a T-Mobile commercial not too long ago, so I have all these people running up to me saying, "You need to work on your free throws." And it was kind of off-putting at first because I don't know what they were talking about. I'm like, "You seriously? Like, I work on my free throws every day." But yeah, I've been doing a little bit of acting, but the way that Curb has influenced me, or just hip-hop theater in general has influenced me, is just the fact that theater requires one take. In film, you get several takes. And I think I've gotten so much more comfortable on set now because I know I can mess up. On stage, like, the pressure of, like, not being able to mess up is, like, so much greater than when you're on camera, like, with a crew and people are like, "Oh, can you just do that again a little bit, like, a little different?" Nobody's going to do that on stage. You might get booed, especially in hip-hop. I think one of the – I have a story. The first time I entered an MC contest at RCC, of all places, and it was like a improv kind of like battle thing. And I get up there and I'm doing my thing and like I hear like whispers because people are like, "He's not that good." And like the whispers get louder and they're like, "Get him off the stage." And then to get him off the stage becomes boo. And then all of a sudden I'm like not in the contest anymore. So those kind of like instances in my life have like really been instrumental both on stage and off stage. In the film and in theater, because, like I said, you get one shot to do this thing. And I
would
think
you get booed off now?
Probably so.
Well, you know, and I just want to add. I mean, Eric is being pretty modest about the types of commercials and the work that he does. But the thing about Eric is, I know that I can ask him to do a thing, and that thing is going to be done as well as it can be done. So when we did, you know, we did a hip-hop theater performance called Uncovered, where we created life-size versions of classic hip-hop album covers using tableaus. And for that performance, for both performances, we've done two versions of it, I asked them, you know, "Okay, I need you to play this role. You know, I need you to be this character." And his dedication and his ability to do those things, and this, you know, is amazing. And his writing, you know, he wrote a narrative for Uncovered so that he placed each of the album covers from Run DMC to LL to Salt and Pepper to MC Light to Jay-Z to Pac and Biggie. He put them within a continuum, within a context that made sense. And it wasn't so much that we arranged them the way he wrote it, but we arranged them the way we had to arrange them in a museum, and then he had the ability to contextualize them in a way that made sense. So
working within the constraints.
This is what we have. Let's make it work.
Freedom in a box, like he always says.
I want to go over some of the works that you've done, because just the premises alone, I think, are so illustrative of some of the things you're saying. So, for instance, we covered Dreamscape.
Yes.
We mentioned Hamlet. That was real. There was a hip-hop version of Hamlet.
Yes.
And then there's a Wagner opera.
Yes, I did an adaptation of Richard Wagner's Ring Cycle. It's called Keep Heads Ringing, and it's a hip-hop opera. And this is a play that that I envision taking the best elements, as far as I'm concerned, from grand opera and the best elements from hip-hop music and combining them, bringing an orchestra on stage to work and to play music with a live DJ.
Let me go over some of the others.
Yes.
We mentioned Buckworld 1
yes.
and Crump. You did another one that intrigues me, One Size Fits All.
One Size Fits All. One Size Fits All explores, I've gotten good at these little blurbs, it explores the abuse of children around the world by following the life of a pair of sneakers as the through line. So we see the sneakers being made by a kid in Indonesia. Then we see the sneakers being worn by a child soldier in Eastern Europe. Then we see the sneakers being purchased by a kid who joins a gang so he could afford $200 sneakers. And then we see the same sneakers being worn by a kid in the sugarcane fields of Haiti, of the Dominican Republic. And so the journey, the sneakers, this metaphor becomes the way that we explore the multifaceted ways in which we abuse children.
You use these symbols to illustrate some of the plights of these various cultural elements. And these symbols are so pedestrian, they're so ordinary, and yet they highlight all of these cultural issues. Yeah.
Well, you know what's so great about being a writer and being a playwright is you can take something that appears to be simple, and this goes back to looking at lyrics and looking at subtext and looking at, you know, what sample this artist decided to use for this particular song. And there can be so much more infused in there. And so when I talk about my writing, you know, August Wilson talks about the fact that his writing had the rhythm of the blues. And so when I write, the rhythm and the aesthetics are that of hip hop culture. It's you know, understanding that if I'm a DJ, I can stop time by stopping the record. And I can go backwards and do that thing again because I have this ability to tell a story in a very different way than it's being told by someone whose aesthetic influences the blues.
Now, as a live program, we're going to go to a different story, and that is we go to what the callers want to ask us about. So I'm going out to Crestline. Ron, thank you for calling. What's your question?
I was wondering if the professor had adapted, or is planning to adapt, any other Shakespeare besides Hamlet.
My plan is not necessarily the adaptation of a more Shakespeare, but there are a couple of other hip-hop theater artists. I always love to give shout-outs and give dap to other hip-hop artists. So there are these young men called the Q Brothers, Q as in Q, and they have decided to adapt all 37 of Shakespeare's plays. And so I think they've done five so far. One of them is called Bombardy of Errors. And I cannot, man, they're going to be mad because I can't remember some of the other names. But they have, as part of their mission, they have decided that they're going to adapt these plays into, you know, give them a hip-hop flavor. And what's great about seeing that happen is it starts to create a library. It starts to create a place where young people who aren't necessarily where I am or where Eric is can go to, you know, can go online and find these scripts and see that, wow, you know, this is this story, but it's being told with this type of flavor. So there are people doing amazing work within this genre of theater. And the more, you know, people like Will Power and I always like to mention a few people, Claudia Alec, you know, they're doing amazing work within this genre of theater. And I'm not so adamant about what you call it. Like, let's call it hip-hop theater just so that, you know, 11-year-old kids who are into hip-hop, who like beatboxing, will come to see Dreamscape and be moved by the work. But, you know, it doesn't matter what you call it. It really is popular culture. It's American popular culture in a lot of ways. And it's just looking at how we tell stories with, you know, once again, using these elements and keeping it interesting and compelling.
So you drew in an 11-year-old, for instance, you gave that example.
Yes.
So let me ask you, Eric, if the Obama effect that Chris was talking about on our video piece, is that Obama effect real? I mean, you're a little younger. You would have that observation.
I think to a certain extent it is, simply because now you have somebody that looks like you and probably one of the most powerful positions in the world. Now, we've always been told, and this is something I've shared with Curb, when I was coming up, I'm a very tall person. So the first thing everybody told me was, you're going to play basketball, and that was it. It almost felt like I had no other option but to play basketball. The second option I was given was, oh, you can be an entertainer. And then the third option was college. That's like way down the list of things when that education probably should be the first thing. But what Obama does is it gives us another option as minorities, not only just African Americans, but all minorities and all people in urban spaces. And then you have somebody in an Obama that relates with you, like he was saying in the video, that gives pound to his wife or brushes his shoulders off when somebody says something negative about him. Like, it's almost like it gives you a sense of strengthening your identity, because these are things that we do every day. I give dap to my friends all the time.
So you're saying that Obama is not trying to indicate that he's immersed in the urban culture himself. He's trying to connect to those that are and show that, like you say, there's a different path.
And I'm not even certain that it's something that he's trying to do on purpose. My connection with Obama happened because he said he watched ESPN and SportsCenter highlights over and over again. And that's something I do. I get off from work and I watch the same SportsCenter 5 times in a row. And my girlfriend's like, why are you watching that? It just came on again. And to hear him say that, he related with me. I think a lot of times with hip hop culture, it's important in education because it relates with students. It relates with you.
Then you could take it to the typical STEM. Science, technology, education, mathematics. Once you get somebody engaged and involved, you can teach.
Exactly.
Let's go to another call. We're going out to Orange, and our caller is Jasmine. Jasmine, what's your question?
Hi, this question's for Mr. Montgomery. We wanted to know what intrigues him with incorporating hip-hop into his playwright.
Well, I think it probably started off with just knowing that I wasn't going to be a rapper. When that career ended for me, I'm like, okay, there has to be another way that I can use my words. I've always felt that words are powerful. And working with Rickerby just showed me that I could use those words and create something more than just what was on the paper. The paper became alive to me. And it was like I was saying earlier about those spaces in between. Now when I write, I see things in between the spaces of my words that I normally didn't see before I got into graduate school. And I just think it's important that when you're writing, you kind of step away from your writing and you become almost observant of your own writing.
So Eric, let me ask you, do you have to learn the foundations of proper English, or can you bypass that since the lyrics of most hip hop are colloquial?
It's funny that you say that, because a lot of times just dealing with rappers in the last probably 2 or 3 years, once they get signed to a record deal, a linguist comes in and kind of helps them, which is funny to me. They do have to go through grammatical training, so to speak. Not everybody, but some of the people on top, you'd be surprised. They have like grammarians like working side by side with them. And I just thought that was like really, it kind of blew my mind. I'm like, yo, Jay-Z has a linguist with him. Like, what the heck is going on?
So name drop for me. A couple of the people that you have personally hung out with.
Like I said earlier, Kendrick Lamar, the whole TDE, shout out to them. They were really nice to me. Mos Def, Common, the list goes on and on. I just hung out with Murs. Murs is doing something really great at the Lachman Museum in LA. He's merging art and hip hop. So every third Thursday, they're going to have a hip hop showcase at the Lachman Museum. It's the first thing.
And I'm going to end it with that. We're out of time. I want to thank our guests, Rickerby Hinds, Carrie Mikuls, and Eric Montgomery, for joining us this evening. Next week, we'll return to high school dropout prevention by looking at a last chance school where kids who were previously in trouble can get a fresh start. Thank you for watching Plugged Inland.